All right, guys. So I am excited. I have Keith Neumeyer on. I have actually been waiting for a long time to get this cat on, at least probably maybe 2 months. So you guys have been hitting me up. Hey, Johnny Bravo, Silver, man. What do you think about Silver? I'm like, all right. So we've done Bitcoin. We've done gold. And now we have Silver. So Keith is CEO of First Majestic Silver Corporation, and we will be diving into the charts to see, hey, when is this to buy? When is this to sell? If you guys want to trade paper, if not, we got this stuff right here, which I love. If I could, I would marry some of it. My wife would be upset. But Keith, let's take it over to Keith. Keith, give my audience a little background about you, and thank you for coming on.
Sure. Well, it was very nice meeting you, Jay Bravo, for the first time. I've been in the mining sector, the financial markets, for most of my career. Turned 60 this year, and been doing this, since the mid-80s. Worked for the three of the largest national banks in Canada up until the late 80s and until the crash of 87, until actually about 89. And I started working for mining companies in the early 90s. I put together quite a large copper company, which became quite the success. Company called First Quantum Minerals. It's currently still quite active and one of the biggest copper companies in the world. I took a bit of a break in 2000 and put First Majestic together in 2002, wanting to focus on silver because I believe the supply-demand fundamentals for silver are likely the best of any of the metals. And I got quite excited back then. And, interestingly enough, back then we didn't even have solar panels to speak of. We didn't have electric cars to speak of. And still, even without those two major industries, I still saw what I still see today. I'm more bullish today than I ever have been. I set out to put together what, I wanted to be the biggest silver company in the world. We're not quite there yet, but we're in the top, handful of the primary silver companies in the world. We're New York listed, market cap about $2.5 billion, 5,000 employees. All the mines are active in Mexico.
Right on. So from day one, you decided, you know what? I'm going to be a silver guy. I was thinking back in the day, I owned a day spa. And I'm like, you know what? No, I will not be noticed for my hair. So I got out of the hair salon industry. So no one will even recognize me. We don't talk about hair, but you went all gold rather, or I'm sorry, all silver rather than, okay. Hey, since the elephant is sitting in the room, why not gold?
Look, I came from copper, and copper is a very supply-demand fundamental market or industry. Gold, I think, should be in everyone's portfolio. Gold is a currency, and it's the granddaddy of all currencies. I don't look at silver as a currency. I look at silver, it's precious, of course, but I look at even greater than being precious. It's a strategic metal. This call would not be capable without silver. Most of everything that we do in our daily lives requires silver, and it's a very misunderstood and taken for granted metal. And people are slowly educating themselves to that fact. And I'm one of the more vocal silver advocates out there.
Okay. See, for me, I would have to say that me too, but not me too. When you hold this stuff, like I actually do this with my high school students, I'm like, hey guys, okay, so we put this on the table, I'll put this on the table, and then, I'll put one of these on the table, and then I make them like guess the price of each. And it's crazy. They actually will pick silver quite a bit higher than they will gold. But I mean, still relative to what, like gold, no one will say, $2,000. They're more like, I don't know. More so, I don't know. And then they're like, oh, I don't know, $5. I'm like, okay, $20. You guys, anyone want to give me $20? I'll give you this gold piece. And they're looking at, well, it does say 20 on it. I'm like, okay, 40. And then they're like, no, you can keep your gold. But I love holding it. There's something. Can you tell my audience just about something that's in your soul? It's like from God that we should be using this.
Well, I was fascinated by metals from as early as I could remember. As a young kid, I'd play with rocks. I'd be hiking or camping, and I'd be picking rocks up and looking at them, and walking through streams and picking up any kind of interesting rock I could find. So I think it's kind of just in my blood, and you know, as I got older and actually started, you know, seeing metal in my own hands, you know, I remember, you know, in Canada, we, you know, we eliminated silver from the coinage in 1967. And so we had, you know, silver dimes and quarters, and then this was part of our normal currency. When I had one of those in my hand, it made me feel differently than a normal, you know, metal coin. And as we eliminated silver from coinage, you know, it was kind of something we lost, you know, in our system. And I still stayed very interested in the metal. And over time, of course, I own a ton of silver and a ton of gold. But interesting fact that your listeners should know, you're holding those two gold and silver ingot up in front of your audience, but we're mining only 8-1. So, you know, you showed 1 ounce there of gold and 32 ounces of silver. And it's amazing to me that they trade at approximately 70-75-1 in the financial markets, but the mining industry on a worldwide scale is only mining for every 1 ounce of gold, 8 ounces of silver.
Oh my gosh. Now, from what I know, which is very, very a limited amount of knowledge, a lot of stuff uses silver. And, so two things that I want to talk about is how much silver is being used, and are these companies like not sharing like what the uses are, and they're trying to keep their numbers down because if it ever comes out, you can have this FOMO, and then, you know, Samsung or, you know, Apple's like, oh, great, thanks.
Well, I've had Samsung in my office, and I've asked them specifically, how much silver do you use in a yearly basis in all the devices that you manufacture? And they wouldn't tell me. The entire industry, whether it's the auto industry, the electronics industry, you name it, they will not tell you how much silver they need. And not just silver. They won't tell you anything about what goes in their products because they're paranoid that investors like ourselves are going to front run them and drive the metal prices up like we've seen in cobalt and lithium and palladium. And because these are very small markets. You know, you asked how much metal is being produced. Well, the mining sector as a whole, in 2020, we don't exactly know what the number is yet, but it'll be somewhere just shy of 800 million ounces of silver. We're consuming, as the human race, something a little bit over 1 billion ounces of silver. So there's a deficit of about 200 million ounces of silver annually, and this deficit goes back multiple years. You can go back right into the 80s when photography was eliminated and computers took over the photographic industry. So you said yourself, it's used everywhere. You know, every device, your automobile, your refrigerator, your toaster, your, you know, all the devices that we take for granted, the microphone in front of you, everything has got silver in it. And we're consuming it at alarming rates, and the mining sector just can't simply keep up with it.
And also the in regards to, because I'm a trader, the manipulation, the stuff that goes on behind the scenes. And when I share with people, I'm like, you guys, you know how much silver is being used? They're like, oh, I don't want to hear about it. Like, wait, no, this is being manipulated. Oh, yeah, right. Okay, nice tinfoil hat you got on there, Johnny Bravo. I'm like, no, I trade. I know when something's manipulated. I can tell you when Bitcoin's manipulated. I can tell you when silver's manipulated. And then these guys get busted. So if you had a magic wand, because they got hit with, what did the banks get hit with? $1 billion, even though they probably walked away with, what, $20 billion? What, give us the background on that.
That's just one of the banks. There's been multiple lawsuits and multiple fines in the tens of billions of dollars in fines over the last 4 or 5 years. You know, and you know, I'm not going to sit here and name all the banks. It's ridiculous, though. But it's not just the silver market. Every market's manipulated, right? From the currency markets, the interest rate markets. You know, I don't know. I've said it before, but I don't know what the governments, you know, why the governments think that their electorate has given them permission to manipulate the markets on a worldwide scale. They think they're doing it for us, or, you know, they think they're doing it for their populace, but actually they're trying to eliminate business cycles, and you just simply can't do it. It's unnatural. And you know, so if gold is up, there's something must be wrong in the business cycle. So, you know, they not smash gold down, so everyone goes and buys U.S. dollars or something. I just use that as an example. But, you know, it is what it is. You know, I think the manipulation is going to go away because ultimately, and this is why I started the silver company, is that supply demand fundamentals have to prevail. Because at the end of the day, they need physical metal for industry. Gold's a little bit of a different case because they can hide a lot of stuff in the gold trade. You know, there's a lot of paper gold out there, and you look at the amount of paper gold that trades on a daily basis, it's pretty ridiculous. But silver is a lot more difficult to manage because it does get consumed up. So if you're Sony and you want your 50 million ounces of silver for your televisions that you're producing worldwide, you're going to call up JP Morgan or HSBC and have a contract with them to deliver your ounces over the next 12-month period. And it's in those banks' best interest to keep that metal price, that silver price, within a trading range whereby, you know, they don't lose their shirt on that short position, because now they're obligated to deliver that metal to that particular specific consumer. So that's really where that short position is coming from. It's actually a commercial short. But ultimately, I think what's going to happen is these banks are going to have to stop doing these long-term contracts and start dealing in more of a spot market basis.
Now, how is that going to happen? Because I feel like I gave away my soul in 2008. I've been a fundamentals guy. I teach high school business. And I'm like, okay, guys, we're going to look at the PE ratio. And then around 2009, the kids are like, Mr. Bravo, what you're saying isn't making any sense. I had to go back. I'm like, all right, kids, we are now throwing fundamentals out the window. Let's just do this. And so I've had to completely change, lost my soul. Thank you, Fed. So in regards to that, you're saying it, at some point it has to go, which I agree. But is it in my life? Is it in my kids' life? Well, can you give me a window?
Look, I'd love to have a crystal ball as well, because I'd love to make that trade. You know, I'm all in as it is, so I'll make money either way, if it happens tomorrow or whether it's going to happen 5 years from now. But I think the palladium market really shows us a lot, you know, where the banks actually lost control of that metal. You know, palladium is even a much smaller market than silver. You know, I didn't get into the numbers on the size of the silver market, but at current metal prices, you know, we're in about a $23 or $24 billion market. That's a pretty small market when it could fit into Apple's market cap. Apple could buy the entire silver sector with what's in its treasury. You know, and the palladium sector is, I think, about a quarter of the size as the silver sector. I'd have to check that fact for sure, but it's definitely quite a lot smaller. And just last year, we saw palladium go from $800 to $2,400 an ounce, pretty well breaking all the banks. And now the banks are out of that trade, and they're not going to go back to it. So I think a similar type of trade has to happen. And, you know, the Sonys of the world, the Samsungs of the world, Teslas, you know, whomever the big consumers of this metal is, silver, they're just going to have to accept that they have to buy the metal in the spot market. And simple as that. They can't rely on the paper markets like they do or they historically have.
So they keep putting fires out, but at some point, like palladium, it breaks. So now you see a natural progression of palladium. And would you say that would be a good, I mean, we can't say what's good or what's not, but a financial position, palladium, since it looks, are you saying there's actually something out there that is market driven?
Well, you know, eventually, you know, if you're a believer in markets, and I am, because I believe all markets have to eventually be controlled by supply demand fundamentals. There's times, and quite lengthy times we're experiencing now, where whatever it is, it's the banks, it's the governments, whoever the case may be, tries to maintain a certain price for an extended period of time. Right now we're seeing interest rates. You know, the Fed is trying to hold interest rates down as best they can. You know, are you going to say they're going to be successful for the next 20 years? I doubt it. How long they're going to be successful for, I don't know. You know, you look at the 10-year bond and it looks like it wants to break through, you know, one. And if it does, you know, that could change a lot of things. So, you know, the governments are trying their best to keep this market in line to whatever kind of financial parameters they think are right for the system. But eventually these types of manipulative actions do break. And we've seen it in uranium. We've seen it in palladium. We've seen it in cobalt. And I think we'll see it in silver.
Oh, wow. I hope so. Now let's talk about the second elephant that is in the room, but happens to be invisible. I had the hardest time when my high school kids were coming in. They're like, Johnny, Mr. Bravo, there's this thing called Bitcoin, and it's a it just beat the dollar. It's cost more for something that's invisible that you cannot hold. You cannot. It's the weirdest thing, like, to wrap your head around. And I'm like, that's just crazy nonsense. I can't believe it. But then after I really started doing my due diligence, my research, I'm like, this kind of makes some sense. 21 million, limited supply. I can get on a plane with it. I can remember it. I have my keys. I don't have to carry, you know, blocks of gold with me. I like this as a store of wealth. What's your take on Bitcoin?
Well, I don't own it. You know, it's not going to work without the internet. So, you know, that's one thing that concerns me. You know, if all of a sudden there's a solar flare and wipes out the entire electrical grid on the planet, your Bitcoin will be worthless. Your silver will still be worth a lot of money. And you can still use it for whatever you wish to use it for. But, you know, hopefully that never happens. I regret buying it. I remember learning about it the first time around $200. And I tried to figure out how to buy it, and I couldn't figure out how to buy it. And this is, I forget what year it was, but over 5 years ago. And I couldn't find anyone that would teach me how to buy it. So it's one of those lost opportunities, which I regret. But, you know, I look at it, and of course, you know, being in the gold, silver sector, I hear about it all the time. I can't admit I thoroughly understand it, but it's interesting. You know, my kids, for example, ask me about it all the time. So, you know, maybe it's the gold for millennials. I don't know. Maybe older guys like me just can't get their head wrapped around it. I don't know. Because I just find like Rickards, for example, or Peter Schiff, you know, guys kind of in the baby boomer age don't seem to really, you know, jump on board. But it's, you know, whether that's the, I don't know if that's true or not. But
yeah, actually, I had Peter on. I also had my daughter, who's just turned 26. Yeah, I said, look at that. You're closer to 30 than you are 20. And she's like, look at you. You're closer to 100 than you are one. I'm like, you got me. But yeah, so Peter was on. He did say he'd vote for me for president. So that was good. But then, you know, we talked about the good old Bitcoin. And him and my daughter started arguing. I'm like, okay, enough is enough. Because kids are digital. They like it. And I agree. If we have a flare, it wipes, you know, it's gone. Maybe. I'm thinking like if you have it off on a, that would be for some of my other guests to explain. But I've mined it back in the day, 2017. I had rigs and computers upstairs, and I had, I was building, and it was great. It was cool. And my wife's like, that's it. You're done. Get it out of here. This thing's louder than Hades. And it's hot. So if you mine for it, it gets real hot. But yeah, no, I'm a Bitcoin guy. My, whenever I talk about it on my channel, my audience, for the most part, they don't like that. I'd say they're more gold in stocks. Okay. And I'm like, okay, well, can we just, you know, have an okay conversation? But now last but not least, I want to look at Silver Majestic Corporation, if you don't mind.
First Majestic?
What did I say? Did I say Silver?
Silver Majestic.
Oh, yes. First Majestic Silver. All right. Right. Let's do a little share my screen, and then you can kind of give me the run. Well, actually, let me tell my audience, you guys, well, the first thing that I look at, and for those of you that are like, what are all these bars and things like that? This is, I use TradingView. And the first thing that I look at is this white line right there. That's my 200-day moving average. I actually move it to 180 because I like to beat out other traders. I want to get in before, I want to get out before. So like in this zone, this was, this is when everyone got called to the carpet in, right, March. Yeah, I was out. I was actually out of Bitcoin at 8,300 before this all went down. So you had the dip, everyone liquidate, everyone's like, get out. We got to get out of our positions, but you're back. You're on a tear. I'd say we're bull market, since, you know, 2019. And then you guys bounced. Look at this. Look at the trend. It's like bounce, comes down, retests. And then there's your next opportunity to buy. And for those of you like, wow, you have like buy and sell indicators. I'm a swing trader, so I actually can tell you exactly when to buy, when to sell, and link in the description, guys. Sorry for selling myself out on the channel, but $200, it's normally $1,000. But Keith, if you could just walk me through this, because I'm sure you look at things like this.
Not really. I do, of course, look at the stock a couple of times a day or sometimes more. But, I put this company together 18 years ago. I'm a significant shareholder. My position does not go down. It never has gone down in history of the company. My position's actually increased by, I think, about 50,000 shares just in the last month or so. I'm always trying to add. And I'm a long-term player because I think that we're going to see triple-digit silver. Our stock has seen $25 three times in the 18-year period. Today it's half that price approximately. And the company has never been healthier than it's been in its entire life. We've got over $200 million in the bank. I think it's more like $225 million in the bank. We're highly profitable at current metal prices. We're growing the business. Our production is growing. 2021 and 2022 are going to be two growth years back to back for us. And our costs are, we're working on driving our costs down. One of our mines is being converted from diesel to LNG, which is going to drive costs down there quite a lot and also improve the environmental footprint for that operation, which is a big deal. So all these things, I think, will help the share price. And of course, if I'm right on the silver price, if we do in fact see triple digit silver, which I'm expecting to see over the next 2 to 3 years, obviously a company like First Majestic is going to be a huge beneficiary of that type of move in silver.
And it seems to me like you guys follow pretty closely to silver, which I mm-hmm. really like. So
we're the purest silver company in the world. So 60% of our revenue is from silver, which is pretty unique. The other 40% is gold. So we only produce two metals. A lot of the miners that you may be aware of that call themselves silver companies, if you look a little bit deeper, you'll find that, in fact, they're not really silver companies. They may have 20% of the revenue is silver, 30% of the revenue is silver, but there's a whole handful of them out there that call themselves silver companies, and in fact, they're below 50%, but they like to call themselves silver companies because they want that extra leverage to the price of silver.
Right. I got it. That's awesome. And if you could just, so we can tie this all up, Keith, if you want to end with your last words, whatever you would like my audience to do, because I just want to say thank you so much for coming on. It's been a blessing. Really appreciate the knowledge, but go ahead. I'll leave you with closing.
Sure. Well, thanks for that. Just, I think the supply demand fundamentals for silver has not been any better. We have an industry, the solar panel industry, that's now consuming over 10%, close to 14% of the entire production of silver. We've got the auto sector, and some stats I'll throw out to your listening audience if they care. There's 1.4 billion cars sitting on the surface of the earth today. There was 2.4 million electric cars produced in 2019 out of 90 million cars produced in the entire year. So if governments want to replace fuel combustion cars, as they're saying they are, you got California, you got many countries, many cities around the world saying, we're not going to let fuel combustion cars in our cities, in our countries, by X dates, the production of electric cars have to dramatically increase over the next 5 to 10, 15, 20 years. That's going to require an enormous amount of silver. We're not producing enough silver right now to actually supply that demand. We need much, much higher metal prices, silver prices, to actually force the miners like us to raise the capital necessary to go and spend the money to develop mines to mine that silver. It's very difficult to do, and it takes months it takes decades to put a silver mine into production. So I think that, I'm excited as always or ever I have been putting together this company, and, people should really have a look. Just go to the website. There's a great PowerPoint there. And if you want to follow me on Twitter, it's just Keith_Neumeyer, and do your own due diligence.
All right, let me pull that up just for my audience here, First Majestic, so they can take a little gander. And let's do the share screen. And there we go. Share. And there it is. There is no substitute for silver. And you guys are... you have some mines out here in California, right?
No, just all in Mexico.
Oh, okay. All right. I thought I saw something in San Dimas. Oh, there's my San Dimas. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Perfect. All right, Keith. Well, again, thank you. Let me stop that.
And you know yourself, being in California, the government there has legislated the use of solar panels for all new houses.
Oh.
And California is often the first one to bring in these types of legislation. So you're going to see other states, other countries around the world also bringing in legislation like that. You know, flying over Tokyo is a pretty amazing thing. You know, you'd think, you know, the scuttlebutt is, oh, Japan's going to turn the nuclear plants back on. No, they're not. They're going completely solar. That's why 14% of all silver produced is getting gobbled up in the solar industry. And we're going to see the same thing happen in the automobile industry.
Well, I'm doing my best to leave California, Keith.
I know a few of my friends that have done the same thing. So
yeah, it's sad when Puerto Rico starts looking really dang good. Crazy.
Yeah.
All right, man. Well, again,
thank Texas.
You. Thank you again for coming on. And I hope to have you again. And I'm sure my audience will really like that. So thank you.
Thanks for your time today.